Okay, good evening. I'd like to welcome you all to the regularly scheduled meeting of the Monrovia City Council this Tuesday, March 3rd. If you're seeing this at home and you have not voted yet, there's still time, and you can run down to the library or the community center, and we'd all love to see you do that. This evening, our invocation will be led by... There he is. I couldn't see you there for a minute. Our chaplain, police chaplain Terrence Brown, followed by our Pledge of Allegiance by Councilmember Shevlin. Please rise.
Let us pray. Qualified city staff, concerned city council members, proactive police and fire departments, passionate community leaders willing to embrace challenges regardless of complexity and difficulty, courageously rallying together for the common good. These and other blessings you have graciously supplied and provided for our beloved city countless times over. May your continued love, favor, guidance, support, and wisdom be ever present and available tonight and beyond. In your glorious name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Will you please join me now to our grand old flag. Ready, begin.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, and liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Pastor Terrence. Always good to see you. Alice, if you would note that the entire council is in attendance this evening, we have no closed session to report. Antonio, how's our high school doing?
It's doing great. Congratulations to MHS Color Guard for winning first place divisions Classics AAA this past Saturday at the WGAS Signature Show. They are now seated in the top 10 as they start their focus towards the WGASC Championship. This Friday is a people-free day and there will be no school for MHS students. Next week is Togetherness Week, and ASB will be trying to create a happier environment at the high school with games at lunch and happiness posters all around the school. The clubs of Monrovia will be selling food on Tuesday and Thursday. Next Friday is Mr. Monrovia. 13 of our seniors will compete to be the next Mr. Monrovia. The theme of this year is Monrovia's Most Wanted. Tickets are $5 and can be purchased from any contestant or $5 at the door. Come out and see who will be Monrovia's Most Wanted. On Tuesday the 17th, ASB and class elections will take place, and the winners will be announced Wednesday the 18th. And that's all I have to report.
All right. Thank you very much. Appreciate you being here. I'll entertain a motion on the consent calendar.
Move for approval.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Any objection? Then that will stand approved. Thank you. We now move on to public input. This is the portion of the council's agenda set aside for any member of the public to address the council on any item that is not on our current agenda, and all we need is your name, and I think we have some speaker cards.
We do, beginning with Dominique Strivings.
Welcome, Dominique.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor and Council. I am here for my final pitch for Fuzz Fest, which is next Friday the 13th. This is our fifth annual Old Town Monrovia Fuzz Fest, a head shaving event supporting the St. Baldrick's Foundation and raising funds for childhood cancer. It's Friday, March 13th from 5 to 9 o'clock in Library Park. Registration begins at 5 o'clock. Shaving will start at 5:30. This year, again, we have our MC Mastery and Music, once again sponsored by the Monrovia Music Festival, featuring the whistling diva Miss Caroline Kaufman. Special guest performances by Celtish, a Celtic cover band playing authentic Irish songs, as well as modern favorites with a Celtic flair. And the Gordon Highlanders and a young girls Irish and Scottish dance group that's actually based here in Monrovia. St. Patty's Photo Booth, sponsored by Shutterbox. Face Painting, sponsored by Kiwanis Club Monrovia. Bake Sale and Festive Cotton Candy Booth, hosted by Center Stage, and more. New this year, we will be awarding the first and second place top fundraising earners for both kids and adults. Top earning winners will be based on their totals as of the event night, so visit our website to help your favorite participant reach their goals. All participants and walk-up donations of over $50 will be able to enter a raffle for prizes as well. Raffle winners must be present to win at the time of the raffle at 8 o'clock. Thank you to all of our generous businesses who donated goods and services for prizes. Those include Sauté Cooking Academy, Sticks Board Shop, the Monrovian Restaurant, House of Windsor, Caddy Wumpus, Studio Movie Grill, Paradise Ice Cream, Basin 141, and more. Also included for all 50-plus participants and donations on the event day, we are excited to provide a custom swag bag with our FuzzFest logo featuring all of our monetary sponsors for this year's event. Thank you for 5 years of continued support to Kiwanis Club and to Monrovia Fire. Also this year for monetary donations, Shutterbox, Christmas Light Guy, Three Beauty Bar, Seba Real Estate, Rotary Club of Monrovia, and Move Your Mountain Fitness. And an extra special thank you for our swag bag production sponsors, Michael Gonzalez with Dilbeck Real Estate and Stubby's Promotions. Thank you also to our partners, Ronspirations, for helping us spread the word about the St. Baldrick's Foundation and the FuzzFest. Look for our booth this Friday at the street fair to get more info about FuzzFest, register to participate, or just say hi. Looking forward to another successful year raising money to fund childhood cancer research. You can find our website at stbaldricks.org/events/FuzzFest20. And our website and email, monroviafuzzfest@gmail.com.
And that's it. And I think I've heard that Mr. Shevlin will be showing up with a head full of green hair for you to shave.
Yes, he will be green for 2.5 days this year.
Good. Thank you, Dominic.
Sari Canales.
Welcome, Sari.
Good evening, City Council and Mayor. Just wanted to thank Becky and Tom for attending the Pocket Latte ribbon cutting. We had a great time there, and they gave us a history on what was occupied there. I believe it was Area 51, 54. So that was very interesting. Very good chunk. The new members that we have 5 new members since the last time we met, and we have Spa Botanicals Day Spa, Hop Secret Brewing Company, and Aloha Junk Removal, and Iwani Cooling and Heating, and then Margaret Halakuni Florist. So very nice to have those new members. Our upcoming events are a ribbon cutting for Striving's loan signing services at 4:30 tomorrow at the Chamber office, and another ribbon cutting, Liebman Tax Strategies, at 4:30 next week. Our lunch mob is March 18th, and it is at Noodle Star. The Chamber will be participating in the following upcoming city events, and we're looking forward to it. The MAP Conference on April 4th, the Spring Egg Hunt and Healthy Kids Day, and the Wine Walk. And also save the date for a business conference and expo, which is April 24th at the Doubletree Hotel. Thank you, and have a great week.
Thank you, Sari. We have no other speaker cards. If there's anyone, yes, sir. Just come on up to the podium. All we need is your name. Welcome.
Good evening, Council, Mayor Adams. My name is Charles Gabriels. I'm a semi-retired real estate broker with an office here in Monrovia for about 10 years. And I'm not a public speaker, so I brought notes. Tonight, I'd like to address the reduction of communicable diseases. Are you all aware of the Monrovia Christmas dinner for seniors at our community center every year?
Why don't you go ahead and tell us what you'd like to? We hesitate to stop you so we can answer questions.
thank you. Well, so you do not think I'm fresh off the boat. 6 or 7 years ago, only 1 month before Christmas, I approached the Monrovia Chamber of Commerce and suggested we put on a Christmas dinner for the Live Alone seniors. They said, too late. I said, no, perfect timing. If we promote too soon, people will forget. I organized the entire thing, and 3 weeks after the 3 weeks later, the community center banquet hall was filled. During my time in Monrovia, I've tried to, in my own ways, to make contributions. One donor I located was the Arcadia Sioux Plantation. Are you all familiar with it, having been there once or twice? I'm sure you have. That's how I became acquainted with the owner, Robert, who donated our salads that first year. A few short years ago, not too far from here, I sold a home to some folks from Sri Lanka off the coast of India. When invited to dinner, I was astonished to see they ate with their hands, using their fingers of the right hand as a scoop, their left reserved for toilet matters. This is merely an example of how different cultures perform in unanticipated ways. Frequenting the soup plantation on average of once a month, for years I've pestered Robert, the owner, to reverse the handles on his two restroom doors. Today, many public restrooms are paperless and use airflow dryers. So it doesn't matter whether you wash your hands if the person leaving before you did not and grabbed that handle with filthy hands. So for the sake of Monrovia Community Health, I'm wondering if the city council could somehow pass an ordinance that all public restrooms be modified to have the door pull handles on the outside. If Monrovia set an example, perhaps the city or county of Los Angeles could do the same. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for coming. Is there anyone else that would like to address the council on any item? Yes, sir. Come on down. All we need is your name when you get to the microphone.
Good evening. My name is Matthew Castle. My wife, Heather Castle, is here as well. We've been residents of the city of Monrovia for about 3 years now, and we've really been planting roots in the city. Our children going to the public schools. We attend Monrovia Mountainside Communion Church, and my wife has actually been involved in a number of affordable housing matters with Mountainside. And we actually find ourselves involved in an issue of affordable housing at the moment ourselves. So back in 2008, some friends of ours had the opportunity to purchase a house in the city of Monrovia with the assistance of the Monrovia Redevelopment Agency. And it was a wonderful program that they really benefited from as a young couple. And now we have the opportunity to purchase this house from our friends. And we have the opportunity to, in fact, take advantage of the same program, the funds from the state of California. So based on our gross income and all these things, we missed the qualification or eligibility on income by $436, just $436. And so we're here just to bring the matter forward to ask you to be our advocates in this specific situation. We believe we have some avenues for flexibility to, you know, allow ourselves to find eligibility. But also that this wouldn't just be about us, that this would be about affordable housing in a wider sense for all residents of the city. So we hope that we can have your support in our matter, but then also in future endeavors as well. Thank you.
Great. Thank you, sir. Appreciate you coming down. Is there anyone else that would like to address the council on Brian Tindall? How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good.
My name is Brian Tindall. I wanted to say thank you to Dylan for the excellent city manager report about the bear issue. I thought that was very in-depth and kind of educated people, as I'm sure everybody actually, I got a phone call from Massachusetts from my grandmother who wanted to know if we were safe because of the bear. So everyone on planet Earth knows that we had a bear. It's been handled. I know it's not really a city issue. And I've been around and know kind of how city works a little bit to know that there's not a whole lot we can do about this. My biggest concern is I saw nothing short of idiots 5 feet from a wild animal. I'm perfectly fine if they want to do that and get mauled. But what's going to happen is the bear is going to get put down. So I don't know if there's something that we can do. I know that we couldn't cordon off a crime scene. It's impossible to cordon off a wild animal. And I know that we have to wait for fishing game to come as well. But I don't know if there's something that somebody who's smarter than me can think of that we can do to prevent wild animals that we care about and live in our backyards from being put down because of idiots. So that's all. And thank you for the report. That was very helpful.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian. Is there anyone else that would like to address the council on any item that is not on this current agenda? Seeing and hearing none, we will close that. And we'll move on to PH1 is a public hearing for the Arroyo at Monrovia Station specific plan. Sherry Bermejo, our planning division manager, will give us a staff report. Welcome, Sherry.
Yes, good evening, Mayor and members of the City Council. Very shortly, we'll have our presentation up, but it's my pleasure to present to you tonight the Arroyo at Monrovia Station specific plan and mixed-use development. This is a transit-oriented development that's proposed within the heart of the city's Station Square Transit Village. The applicant is Matt Waken of MW Investment Group. So the project, as I said, is a mixed-use transit-oriented development. It proposes 302 residential units, and of those residential units, 15 are going to be designated for affordable families to the very low income level. It includes 3 live-work units, 7,080 square feet of commercial space, and a 500 parking garage. Now, as I mentioned, this project is in the heart of Station Square. It encompasses nearly an entire block, and as shown on this general plan map, you can see that it has a unique shape in that it includes the entire block except for one existing residential property located on Evergreen, 230 West Evergreen. And it's bound by Evergreen to the north, Magnolia to the west, Pomona to the south, Magnolia and Primrose to the west. Now, very early on, it was very important for the planning division staff to have a conversation about project objectives regarding this large project. We typically ask questions, you know, what are the unique things that this project's going to propose for the community of Monrovia, and what are the benefits that it has to offer? So early on, we set some projects with the developer, and this is what the project proposes. It proposes to increase the housing options here in Monrovia, providing attractive housing with a variety of amenities near the transit station. This project's 400 feet within walking distance of the Monrovia Gold Line. And it proposes a variety of unit type mix, 62 studios, 136 one-bedroom, and 104 two-bedroom units, 3 live-works units, and then, of course, 15 affordable units to the very low-income levels. And those affordable units are actually dispersed across the various unit mix. It also proposes a project that provides the infrastructure that will support the project throughout its lifetime. And then the highlighted public benefits include paid public parking, 19 additional public parking spaces, a good amount of commercial space, 7,080 square feet of commercial space. And why that's important is because that commercial space is going to support this new transit village with a lot of goods and services that are nearby and within walking distance. It also includes public open space, about 4,500 square feet. And because the project has this unique design, it was very important to us to identify what type of good neighbor provisions or features that could be incorporated into this project. And I'm going to go through those in a little later. But first, what I would like to say is the project was developed in accordance with the Plan Development 12 Station Square Plan Development Standards, and it meets all the standards with the exception of one, and that's floor area ratio. So the project site covers 2 neighborhoods, the residential neighborhood to the north and an industrial neighborhood to the south. Now, within the residential neighborhood, there's no limit on floor area ratio, but in the industrial neighborhood, there is. There's a 2.5 floor area ratio limit when a project proposes structured parking. So taking a look at the numbers proposed, this applicant needed a modification. They're exceeding the FAR limit in this industrial zone, and they're proposing a 3.3 instead of a 2.5. Now, because of this, the applicant is proposing affordable units. And by setting aside 5% of the base units in the proposal, and that base unit number that was proposed was 299 units, they're eligible for a density bonus and an incentive, which is a waiver of this floor area limit. So Now I want to just start talking about the project. This is a high-level image, 5,000 feet in the air, looking down, looking at the project site and how it sits in relation to the other multifamily development projects that have come before the City Council. You can see that to the east is the approved Fifield 127 West Pomona project. To the west, you have the Alexan Foothill project right across the street, the recently constructed MOTA project, and it is within very proximity to the Gold Line station. The site encompasses 12 parcels. It's 2.9 acres. The southern half of the project site is developed with industrial uses. The northern half is developed with residential units. Some of those units are vacant. There's one vacant lot, and there's also a surface parking lot. Now, these images are going to take you through the existing neighborhood, how it is today. And this is a view looking north on South Magnolia Avenue. In the foreground, you can see the project site, the industrial building that's there, and you also see MOTA to the east. Here's a picture of the project site looking north on South Primrose Avenue. Now, this is a view of the residential neighborhood. The house that's located in this photo with the turquoise door, that's the house 230 West Evergreen that's proposing to stay. And as you can see from this photo, although this is a residential neighborhood, it's changed significantly since these homes were originally built in the 1950s. In the backyard of this home, we have industrial buildings, and then further south, we see the MOTA development. To the west, we see a house that's boarded up. And then across the street from these homes is the I-210 freeway, which is an 8-lane freeway.
Terry,
just
a quick question.
Yes.
Were these homes built before we had a freeway?
They were built before the freeway. Yes, they were.
So it was part of a neighborhood that...
At one time, it was part of a neighborhood. The freeway came. The industrial land uses came. And so as it's evolved over time, it's changed significantly.
Thanks.
You're very welcome. So here's the site plan. The site plan designer is Architects Orange. Mike Heinrich is the design architect behind this vision. And he has a lot of deep understanding of the developments in Station Square because he's actually worked on the Alexan, MOTA, and Station Square South. And that understanding has been very important because he's had an idea of how to make these projects interact with each other, not just how the buildings relate on site. So one of the key design features for the Arroyo was the placement of the commercial ground floor at the corner of Primrose and Pomona. So that commercial corner is going to interact with Fifield across the street to the east, and it's also going to entice pedestrians as they're coming up from South Primrose Avenue. Just north of the commercial space are the location of the three live work units. The residential units are highlighted in this tan color. And then the parking garage sits in the center of the development site, and it's wrapped on three sides by the commercial units. And as you can see from this image, there's a lot of open space, and the open space is brought in from Evergreen and as well as Pomona, creating this building to look like multiple buildings instead of one large building. There are also interior physical amenities that are built into the project site, a gym, club room, where the residents can have parties and different types of activities and game nights, and a spa and a leasing office. This site plan kind of highlights the open space provisions that have been designed into the project. As I mentioned earlier before, the project proposes 4,600 square feet of open space. And there are about four little pocket plazas that occur along Pomona Avenue, ranging in size from 400 square feet to close to 2,000 square feet. The residential open space, this is common open space, is in the form of an interior courtyard that offers pool amenities, a roof deck that's located on the eighth level of the parking garage, and then open space is designed around this single family home that's remaining. And what's important to highlight with respect to this last piece of open space that I mentioned is that that's planned as passive open space, meaning it's going to be dense landscaping and really geared towards activities like sitting, relaxing, meditation, things that are going to not generate noise. This covers, shows you the mobility plan. Vehicle circulation is proposed around the entire site. The vehicle access is proposed from West Pomona. Cars will come in here, and they will be exiting on West Evergreen. Now, the project meets all the parking standards. Because this project is using the density bonus ordinance or the density bonus law, the state gives them residential parking standards that are based on the unit type. And although the state requires 406 parking stalls, they are proposing 414. For the commercial component, they are exceeding the city's municipal code requirement. And then in addition to those parking spaces, they are providing a provision of public parking. Now, although they're meeting and exceeding these parking standards, it's important to note that the conditions of approval that we've implemented through all of our recent developments are in place. Then propose the same parking management plan, a review after a year of occupancy that's being issued to make sure the parking is being met, and the creation of an eviction parking program. Now, with this slide, I'd like to talk about the good neighbor features that was implemented into this project. I think it was very key for both the developer and the city staff to make sure we were designing a project that really not just was around this home, but actually was very inclusive. And so with the use and design of applying passive open space around this particular home, we were able to get large setbacks ranging in size from 20 to 40 feet to surround the home. They're proposing an 8-foot tall wall, and that wall is going to mitigate sound around this property, and also a wall adjacent to any mechanical equipment. This open space is going to have limited operation hours between 8 a.m. and 10 p.m. And then when we're looking at how we can incorporate this residential unit to be part of this development, the developer is offering this property owner access to all the amenities within the project. And since there are going to be some short-term construction impacts during the construction of the Arroyo project, the applicant is also offering relocation assistance during that time. So here's a view of the project site. This includes how it would look with that residential unit there in place. This is a view from West Evergreen. You can see that this area is designed with a lot of dense landscaping. They have removed all balconies along the east elevation to reduce privacy impacts. The building height also steps down in this area. The parking garage is the only visible portion of the parking garage is along West Evergreen, and that incorporates opportunities for public art. And this is a rendering looking at the Arroyo at Monrovia Station from South Primrose and West Pomona. The project is in total 84 feet height at this top to the tippy top of that sign. As you can see, it was designed with a very bold commercial ground floor that's differentiated from the residential units above. Here's a similar view. This is a visual sim of how it would look up against the Moda project. And this is a view looking north on South Magnolia. This has a more of a residential feel with the different types of materials that are proposed and the colors, warm colors. It incorporates wood siding and various colors of brick. Balconies are used to add interest, recess windows. And then here's the visual simulation, seeing the project up against the Moda. And then this is a rendering looking at the project along West Pomona Avenue. And as you can see, this is actually the main vehicular entrance, and it's bookended by the leasing office and the gym. You can see this elevation of the project has a lot of jogs in and out. So it's making this one large building look like it's multiple buildings. Okay, so with all large projects, we all know that there's a very lengthy and long environmental review that's required through the California Environmental Quality Act. And this project was not exempt from that. It began its process back in September of last year, and it's gone through all the noticing requirements. Tonight, before the City Council, it is an environmental impact report. And that environmental impact report covers the analysis of all these categories that are listed here in this slide. Now, the categories that are underlined, as you can see, aesthetics or quality, biological resources, and in black text, those are areas of study where we were able to add mitigation measures to reduce impacts to a level of not significant or less than significant. Now, there is one area, and that's the area of noise, where we have mitigation measures, but based on these mitigation measures, they're not enough to reduce impacts to a level of not significant or less than significant. And that's because even though the applicant is proposing to relocate the resident at this location off during the construction, we have no control, the developer has no control of any property owner accepting that. So there is a significant and avoidable impact in the area of short-term construction noise. Now, in order for the City Council to adopt or consider adopting an environmental impact report with an impact that's significant and avoidable, it would first need to consider the adoption of the Statement of Overriding Considerations. And what that is simply there are other provisions that outweigh this short-term significant impact. And so that language is located in a resolution before you tonight. But real briefly, the Planning Commission, staff, and the Development Review Committee do believe that there are significant benefits that outweigh the impact of the short-term noise. And that's because the project would help the city achieve a balance of live-work and job balance, contribute to attaining private investment and redevelopment of a piece of property that's in need of redevelopment. It would help improve and revitalize this area. And it would comply with all the state mandates to put our housing in the high transit located areas so that we reduce vehicle miles traveled. And by the reduction of vehicle miles traveled, we reduce greenhouse gas impacts. So staff is recommending approval. The Planning Commission recommended approval. So before you tonight are a series of resolutions and an ordinance. The first resolution is for the adoption of the Environmental Impact Report, actually certifying the Environmental Impact Report. And that includes the draft EIR, the final EIR, which includes all the comments that were received during the 45-day public review period, the Mitigation Monitoring and Reporting Program, and then the Statement of Overriding Consideration. The zoning ordinance amendment, for the purpose of that, is to add the specific plan designation into the zoning map and amend the zoning code to accommodate the specific plan standards. The adoption of the specific plan, and that contains the land use standards, the design regulations, and land use controls to maintain the project and approve use requests within that commercial space for the life of the project. And then lastly, there's a resolution for the adoption of the vesting tentative tract map. And that's to consolidate all 12 of those parcels into a single parcel, and then a conditional use permit for the construction of the development. So with that, staff is recommending approval, and that concludes my report. And I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Thank you, Sherry. Any questions for Sherry?
On this project, it does not or will not have the Mellow Roos.
That would come at a later date. The conditions of approval are teed up so that they have the option either to pay fire impact fee or enter into the Mellow Roos.
And on that residential lot, are there any long-term plans for that lot?
The property owner is telling us she does not wish to sell. She's very happy living there. I think there are some other unique things that the city is thinking about that I'm going to let Craig respond to.
Okay. And I knowing that we can't force her to move, and she knows this project is coming. The whole project was designed that at some point, if that house, if she moves and the house becomes available, it could be developed as public open space. So the whole project was designed that house at some time in the future will probably go away. We just don't know when that will be.
And it would become, it'd be a public park?
It would be for public open space, yes. And the City Council actually has accepted funding from the developer that if that does become available, that the city will be able to purchase that and improve the park.
And then we would own that?
We would own that.
If I could, I apologize for just stepping in, just because sometimes certain agreements happen outside of the Community Development Department. The city manager's office has worked, you know, just so everyone knows, so we've talked about the owner of the 230 West Evergreen property has been very complimentary to the project. It's just that she simply doesn't want to move. And so the developer has worked with the property owner. The city has worked with both parties to make sure that we plan for the future. One day, she's not going to own the home forever. So what we've agreed to with the developer is what we call an acquisition and development of public park space agreement. And essentially, as part of the development, the developer is providing the city $1 million, which is set aside towards future public park open space procurement when that lot does become available. And the design of the project itself takes that into account, that one day this will be developed as open space. So we'll have the money to do it. When that happens, we just don't know when.
Any other questions for staff? Thank you, Sherry.
Very welcome.
Okay, this is a public hearing. We'll open the public hearing, and I do have a speaker card from, it looks like, Allison Henry from Pasadena. Allison, welcome.
Thank you, and good evening, Council, Mayor. Happy Super Tuesday. My name is Allison Henry. I'm with Everyone in LA. I'm a resident of Pasadena, but my mother and father live here in Monrovia on Lime Avenue. And as I've said in previous city council forums, my older sister also lived in Monrovia until cost and habitability issues actually forced her out of state. She had been a special education teacher at Clifton Middle School. I'm here tonight to do public comment on the need for more affordable units. This is a great project for Monrovia. It's great to see the transit area developed. It's great to get off the train and not have to call my parents for a ride up to their house, but walk on up, shed some of these extra pounds. But I'm just really concerned about how few affordable units there are. If we take the total number of units at 302, 15 low-income units is actually 4.9%. I understand that some of those units might have dropped down to 209 or 299, but this is a really small percentage of affordable units. We know that the current rent burden for residents of LA County is extremely high already. These developments, while precious to our housing stock, don't actually lower housing prices in the city. They actually tend to create what's called rent creep. So we're not looking at a project that's going to alleviate any burdens anytime soon. And especially learning that should the, as my mom would call it, a wee hoose next to this project is purchased, that there's money for public land, I would urge a rethinking, if not on this project, for future projects, to go well above 5%. We know the need is great here in Monrovia. I'll bring back folks in 2 weeks' time to prove that point to you. But if you get out and speak to your city and your constituents, you know that people who do not own their house are really struggling. In some cases, we've got people in this county spending 90% of their income on rent. Once you're priced out of your apartment, it's really hard to get back into a unit. That's just the reality. So when I see how many units are coming online here, it's just a shame that there are so few affordable units. I would really urge all of you to reconsider this project or future projects to reflect more of the economic need of Monrovia. When I look at this project, it's not what Monrovia fully needs. It needs some of it, but there's more affordability needed by the Monrovia community, and this project could certainly reflect that. As I've said to you before, I've got a group of folks who have worked on legislative items like this. We're happy to put our heads together and look at what would really fit Monrovia. But this is just unacceptable, just under 5%. There's so many units coming online. I think Monrovia can do better. Thank you very much.
Thank you. If the applicant would like to speak.
Good evening, Mayor Adams, members of the City Council. My name is Matt Wakin with MW Investment Group. Very excited to be here before you tonight. This has been a process that started almost 4 years ago, the work on this project. And I want to really commend Craig and Sherry and everybody in the staff of Monrovia that worked on this project, Public Works, Fire Department. Everybody did such a great job. And this project went through a number of iterations over the course of 3.5 years. And we spent a lot of time working on acquiring the sites and putting them together. And we spent a lot of time in design review, a lot of time working on the architecture. Sherry outlined it in her staff report. She did a great job. Craig and Sherry really wanted this project to work along with the other developments and really have a sense of communication between the buildings, a lot of articulation, a lot of rich design and good quality, something that looked a little bit different from the other projects that came in there. And so we spent the better part of a year working on design and redesign, and we probably changed this project almost 10 times from start to finish. Again, Sherry did an amazing job of presenting it. And they did an amazing job of helping us design a project which fits within the vision, I think, of what not only the city, but the county of Los Angeles and the state needs with this project. Tonight I have everybody from my teams here, MIG, the environmental preparer, Michael Heinrich from Architects Orange. I've got Jim Kawamura, who's a civil engineer, and I've also got Paul Maskey from MGS, the landscape architect. So my team's here to answer any questions. And with that, I'll end with this. I think a really, really important part of the story of this project, which is different from what you've seen in the other projects that have been presented before you, is that the majority of the projects that you've seen to date in the Station Square area, you know, are in industrial use presently, and they're industrial in nature. This project has the residents along Evergreen, and it's really important to note the residents on Evergreen that wanted to participate in this project. It was all but one, and they've been through a lot over the course of the last 15 years. And if you guys will remember back, and maybe you do, maybe you don't, I do, back in 2007, when there was a specific plan for this project and a developer who was going to develop it all, the city of Monrovia, with the help of redevelopment of the state, went in to acquire all of the residences along that street. And they actually were under contract on the residences on Evergreen. They actually acquired two sites, which are currently owned by the Burke family. And so at that point in time, all the residents felt they were going to be part of a development and they were going to move. And since then, they've really been in what I feel is a state of limbo, and they've had development springing up around them, and really that area's been gentrified. It's very clear it's designated to be Station Square. It's going to be an amazing development, but they've gone through a lot. And at this point in time, they're ready to move on. Traffic is picking up. They've got tall buildings being built around them, and it's really important. And a few of them are here, and I think they want to say a few words to you. I think it's important. They want to move on to the next chapter in their lives and to a location that's more oriented for their families and what they want to do with their lives, and they really don't want to still reside in this location with the development and the growth that's going on. So with that, I'll leave it to them to come up and talk if they want to, and I'm here to answer any questions you guys have for me tonight.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the council? Yes, ma'am. Gail, how are you?
I'm waiting to go home and...
We all are.
...watch voting results, but the lovely lady made a very valid point. She and I, Becky, for a while, were all at the housing thing at Mountainside Community Church on Saturday. I was there for the full thing. It was put on by Mr. Holden. Catherine Barger was there. One of the things that you might like to know is that Assemblyman Holden is fighting to get redevelopment dollars back. I work in downtown LA. A couple of blocks from my office are just countless homeless people. And I was thinking the other day of all you've got to do is get two or three or five of them have a corona with Lyme, have the coronavirus, and you not only ravage that whole intact community, but they are so close to the big businesses that you're going to take the industry out. We have to do more, and I'm really grateful that this place does have some units because it's really been bad in terms of everything is at the high end. I understand there are separate companies and separate businesses and separate housing developments, but damn it, take out a gym. I apologize, because I know how you feel about the bad words, but it really did feel good to say it. Take out the gym, take out the clubhouse, whatever, and put a few more units. I know that there is a cost, but I sat there and have the business cards of the three key speakers that I can connect you with, or you, if you need the information. It was very valid interchange, and we have to do better, because once you filled capacity in that space, you don't have any more options, unless you're going to come out in some other part of the town and develop. And while it may feel really good to gentrify the community, not at the expense of the people that live here. Because clearly there is the homeless population, and then there's the rest of us that are going to be homeless because of one more rent increase or one more fee or because the pricing has gone up. And I do not believe that even though we are putting in all this housing, that it's going to drive the cost down. It may stabilize what is there. They may become stagnant at that rate. A desperate maneuver, maybe you might get them to go down, but that's your baseline. You may stop them from going up, but that's still going to price people out. And I say this on the day that I got a raise and a bonus and all of that kind of stuff. Isn't that cool? But I want to be able to use it, and I don't want it to all go to housing. So I would seriously ask you to give some consideration. Please meet with her. Please meet with the other leaders. That house that is there and the person doesn't want to move, they're doing some really cool things with some really teeny tiny housing units that cost almost no money, and they assume that these people don't have to have parking, so you don't have all of those issues to have to factor in. Have to do better. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Gail.
Thank you.
I hope Mr. Holden is successful. About 3 weeks ago, State Senator Portantino reminded us all that if Sacramento were to return all of the redevelopment money, the local governments in California would have $10 billion to spend on affordable housing. But as of right now, Sacramento's decided to keep the $10 billion up there. Is there anyone else that would like to speak to this item? Yes, anyone, come on. All we need is your name.
Good evening, Mayor Adams, Council. My name is Juan Bañuelos. I live at 210 West Evergreen. I have done that for a little bit over 40 years. As much as I love Monrovia, and I'm going to try to stick around Monrovia, you're not getting rid of me that easy. But it is, I think, overdue that the city, you know, does what they need to do to give me my farewell as far from that area anyways. Matt has worked really, really hard. He has been very respectful and very supportive in every way that you can think of in dealing with us. And I think it's time. You know, I look at the project behind my house, and I, you know, kind of dread coming up my street now. Something that I used to enjoy, it's time. I was in the middle of that first time around when the city was involved. And yeah, I don't know if limbo is even the word to describe it. It has been, you know, difficult to deal with because, you know, we have been kind of like, what's going to happen here? So please, you know, I hope that, you know, the hard work that Matt and everyone else has put together pays off and that, you know, the development goes through. I'm pretty much begging. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else that would like to come on down? All we need is your name.
Terry Prado. Good evening, Mayor, Council, and staff. I had the opportunity to see this project when they were talking about it at the planning division, and I'm concerned about the material that's going to be used. They talked about that there was formaldehyde that was going to be off-gassing into the project, into the community. The people that they that the developer was brought up to speak on it was using federal standards, and I think that we should be using state standards. We should be the leaders, and if we're going to talk about being green and getting green lawnmowers, let's get green buildings. And then now we have another issue. We keep building buildings that we know we're not going to have enough parking. And the fact that we're going to be getting involved in getting people evicted, we should not even be involved in anything like that. We should be providing parking for everybody, knowing that we're going to build a building already starting like that. So you already have more than one building with that conversation on the table. That's not acceptable. You get people to rent here to be residents of Monrovia, and they're going to be coming into an area where they're going to be possibly evicted. So you build 302 units. You should have at least two parking spaces. You have 500. They'll end up on the street, and then they're going to get towed away. Now, how friendly is that for Monrovia? That's not the business we're in. So I'm concerned, again, about the materials that they're using in the project. One of the things that I have a question, was there a traffic study? The representative that the builder used said that they were using Los Angeles standards, and apparently my understanding was there was no traffic study done. I think that we should have a traffic study. I think we should look at the materials that are being used. Are we going to be subsidizing the businesses that are going to be impacted by this? We're talking a couple years here. You're going to put people out of business. So these are issues that I'm concerned about, and I think that for the welfare of all Monrovians. Thank you.
Thank you. And just so you know, we do have a letter from Lozao Drury, I believe, and it's regarding environmental products. And the quote is, the developer will use clean Tier 4 construction equipment for the project and will use wood materials made with CARB-certified, no added formaldehyde resins or ultra-low-emitting formaldehyde resins. Other issues raised by SAFER were addressed in the city's responses to the comments, and SAFER withdraws its comments and fully supports the project based on that change. So, yes, ma'am. All we need is your name.
And I am the daughter-in-law of 234 Evergreen, the home that's boarded up. And that's my mother-in-law, as well as I'm the real estate agent along with that. She had been dealing with back when the city gave her money that they were going to do this back in 07, as Matt talked about. We couldn't sell then. She's 92 years old. We have her in a home. The money for this house would be great to have for her, but we've been on hold for 4 years, and she doesn't have much life left, and we're having to support her as she's living in another home, being cared for. Matt has gone completely out of his way, I believe, to make this a wonderful project. You've got 302 homes. Or residencies that you're going to get out of 12 homes and industrial. It's awesome. I mean, and him giving 15 homes to low income, I think is very gracious. Some projects have none. So I'm just asking to, if we could please get this passed so we can move on. And like I said, it's been almost 4 years this time, and before it was 3 years. And we haven't been able to sell. So she could really use that money. Anyways, thank you.
Thank you. Yes, sir. All we need is your name.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor. Good evening, council members. My name is Shane Traster. I live at 228 West Evergreen with my lovely wife, Sarah, and now my mother and adult sister. Our family is no stranger to the affordable housing crisis in California. I was a special education teacher for 5 years in Richmond, California, in the East Bay, and we were priced out of our home at the end of our lease there after my fifth year teaching. I now work for a nonprofit from home as my wife finishes her teaching credential program, and we're incredibly privileged to rent from our in-laws, who I'm about to paint in a very bad light, I'm sure, but whom we love very much and for whom we are incredibly grateful. I think some incredibly intelligent and thoughtful people have made some really great points about the affordable housing crisis in California. I don't think we could ever build enough affordable housing in California, and certainly 15 units is a good step. But I think the current state of that lot is, the proposed development area is in dire need of help. I'm a millennial who deals with a ton of anxieties about many, many things. But when we moved into this place 2.5 years ago, we were told that we would live there for 6 months before the development was ready to go and we were on our way out. So we never unpacked. And the wedding gifts that we began to receive several months later are in the exact same boxes in the exact same closet where they have sat for over 2 years. As we started to pull things out of individual boxes, those boxes began to sort of spill out across our garage and house. The work that you might do when you move into a place knowing you'll live there for over 3 years, like cleaning it up really well or replacing the water heater that's older than your in-laws, or replacing the fence boards that are going to let your dog loose, you don't do when you're only going to live there 6 months. And then you don't do when you're told 6 more months. And then you don't do when you're told 6 more months. So 2.5 years later, we haven't done the many, many things we would like to do to live in a home where we're going to be living. That's certainly our decision to make. The faucet that I spent 6 hours yesterday replacing is a decision I made. But what I'm here to ask you to do today is to end this process. Let it go. Make it move forward. Allow the people who've experienced this far longer than we have to end their experience and move forward. I think there's a ton that everyone can do to solve the housing crisis in California. I'm not certain we can fix that problem with this development itself, although I'm certain very many smart people are going to tell us exactly what to do here. I am too anxious about too many things to have this be another thing to be anxious about. So please, thank you for your time, and let's be done.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yes, sir. Come on down. All we need is your name.
My name is Brad Ratliff, Mayor Adams and Council. Thanks for letting us all speak. I am the slumlord of that young man there. It has been a while. And by the way, the Planning Commission, great folks. Everything that they have done to help Matt Waken and his project move forward has been incredible. So you've got some great folks there. I have concerns primarily about my daughter and son-in-law's safety. That neighborhood has become blighted. There have been folks that have broken into the boarded-up home to take roost there for a little while. And my children live one house down from that. That's a little disconcerting to me. There are times where the city has asked some of our neighbors to fix up the property, knowing that it's going to be torn down very, very soon. So we, as much as we try to maintain what integrity we can of those pieces of property, we certainly want to move on with our lives. And my children certainly want to move on and have kids. Goodness knows I want to have grandkids soon, but not in that neighborhood. So I implore you to please go ahead and approve all of this stuff so that all of these good folks can get along, get on with their lives and start fresh. So thanks, everybody, for your time.
Thank you, sir. Is there anyone else that would like to address the council on this item? Seeing and hearing none, we will close the public hearing. And are there any questions of staff?
Mayor, before you close, can we just make sure we offer the applicant
a chance to rebut? If the applicant would like to rebut anything, Mr. Waken? No? Okay. Thank you. So then that will remain closed. Sherry, I do have some questions. If you could go back to, I'm a little confused. I think at one point you said it was 6 stories with 7 levels or something along those lines?
Yes. So the project, it's a mixed-use building. The residential component, including the commercial, is a 5-story building, 5 stories but 6 levels. And that's because the top units are loft units, and they include a mezzanine in there. The parking garage is 7 stories, and the 8th level is developed with a rooftop sky deck.
Okay.
Does that help?
And I think you said it's 84 feet high?
It ranges in height from 75 feet to 84 feet high.
And how high is MOTA?
MOTA is 5 stories, and I have a little cheat sheet here. Let me just look at my cheat sheet.
Out of curiosity.
Okay, so MOTA is 60 feet at the base, but there are projections above that 60 feet that accommodate elevator shafts that go up to the roof. So I would estimate about 70 to the top.
70, and this goes up 14 feet above that?
That is correct.
Would this be the highest of everything we've seen in the area so far?
No, it's actually shorter, lower than the Fifield project, which proposes a 95 feet to 101 foot height max. So it's shorter than the project to the east.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Pardon?
Can you address the traffic study?
Yeah, I'd be happy to answer that. As part of the Environmental Quality Act, this project was required to do a very in-depth traffic study where they looked at 8 intersections. They look at the baseline traffic. They superimpose the projected traffic. And that actual analysis indicated that there were no impacts, and so no traffic mitigations are proposed. However, in addition to that, the city conducted its own traffic study within our Station Square, Transit Village, and beyond, and has implemented a traffic impact fee. This project falls within that area and it will be subject to that traffic impact fee to address the cumulative super impacts of all these projects coming online together. And that is a condition of approval in Data Sheet 1.
Any other questions?
So how does the fee offset that?
There's actually no impact. So this is an additional fee to address long-term impacts from all these projects coming online at the same time. Even though the base traffic study that was done through the CEQA process indicated no impacts, the city was still concerned, so we implemented our own traffic impact fee.
So all of the projects within the area that's covered by the fee will pay money into a fund, and then the city uses those funds to do traffic improvements in that area to deal with the cumulative impacts of all of those developments.
Gotcha.
Any other questions?
In talking about timing,
yes. They've
waited a long time in terms of once it's if we approve it this evening, then what's the timeline?
There's a process for filing the final CEQA documents. Then they have to finalize their construction drawings and submit those into building plan check. The construction process could probably around 22 months. I think the applicant has a better understanding of the final negotiation agreement since he's in an agreement to purchase these mm-hmm. properties.
But they could realistically be under construction by the beginning of the fiscal year, so by July. Cool. If they get all their ducks aligned. So really, if the project is approved tonight, the ball is in their court to develop all the documents they need to start construction.
Any other questions for staff?
Yeah, I've got a couple. So this building is obviously right beside a freeway. Are there ways of constructing this building that mitigate air quality issues arising from the 210 freeway?
So the CEQA document, part of the California building code, has a lot of different types of components that are going to include special windows, special air conditioning flows. They're going to keep good air in and send bad air out. All that's been implemented and will be implemented through the design and building plan check.
So I know in the city of Los Angeles, their affordable housing ordinances prohibit mm-hmm. buildings that are this close to a freeway for affordable housing. Would my assumption about that would be that a building of this quality has the ability to build in the kind of protections that mitigate for air quality, whereas if the whole building were affordable housing, there's no way that you could afford to make that air as breathable, and so they're just precluding people building that close to a freeway. I know we don't usually talk about the city of Los Angeles, but affordable housing is definitely something we're all looking at now.
I'm not aware of those laws, but I do know that this project has gone through a very in-depth air quality analysis. The majority of the air quality impacts, the impacts that were early identified have mitigation measures in place to reduce those impacts. The typical air quality impacts that we are most concerned about was during the short-term construction phase, and not so much the long-term phase because of all the building requirements that are going to be built in to make this air quality inside for the building. That is correct.
Being addressed.
And there are a couple, kind of a, two different issues going on here. One is the CEQA analysis, and it's important to remember that CEQA requires that we look at the impacts of the project on the environment, not the environment on the project. So through CEQA, we're not really looking at that, but our, but there's other requirements through the building code, CalGreen, and there's different requirements that we look at the impact of air quality on the project. And so a lot of that is, those mitigations are built into the project. What we can't control is whether or not someone opens their window. But if they keep their windows closed, there are protections that address things like air quality and the impact of the freeway. That's been a big discussion point all over California.
Yes. So obviously then the affordable units won't be constructed differently than the higher end units. They will benefit from these same air quality
absolutely
measures that are built in.
And that's also one of the benefits of having a mixed income project as opposed to a single, you know, a
all affordable.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions or concerns?
I was just going to say, Gloria was correct. You said you hadn't heard of that situation, but yes, they keep the affordable housing, or they won't fund the affordable housing within 500 feet of the freeway.
Hmm. Any other questions or comments? Then I will entertain a motion.
I'd like to make a motion to adopt resolutions number 2020-20, 2020-21, 2020-22, and introduce, waive, and further reading, and read by title only ordinance number 2019-11.
I'll second it.
It's moved and seconded. Any other discussion? I know this has been a long process. You have to understand that once this was completely all done, the state of California came along and took away our redevelopment agency, which basically means we had to take all of our plans and throw them away and start all over again. So my apologies for the delay on everything. And I know we would all love to see more affordable housing. And maybe at some point we can get some more assistance for that. It would be real nice if the state of California would turn loose the $10 billion they're holding of local government money for affordable housing. And we're going to continue to lobby them for that. Any other comments? Alice, please call the roll.
Councilmember Blackburn?
Yes.
Crudgington?
Yes.
Shevlin?
Yes.
Mayor Pro Tem Spicer?
Yes.
And Mayor Adams?
Yes. Please read it.
Ordinance number 2019-11, an ordinance of the City of Monrovia, California, adopting ZA 2019-0005, a zoning ordinance and map amendment amending the official zoning map set forth in section 17.04.040 to change PD plan development to the SP, specific plan zone designation, and amending the zoning ordinance to add the Arroyo at Monrovia Station specific plan to section 17.04.035 of Title 17 zoning of the Monrovia Municipal Code for property located at 202 through 238, not including 230, West Evergreen Avenue, 1551 South Primrose Avenue, and 1610 South Magnolia Avenue. And Mayor, in addition to that, we'll just note that because there is a conditional use permit as part of this application that the council has approved, for that specific item, the time within which judicial review would be sought is governed by Code of Civil Procedure Section 1094.6, as the council's action on this project is final tonight.
Thank you, sir. Thank you all for coming down this evening on that. We will continue on to our reports of city manager and staff. Mr. Feek. We'll take just a couple minutes here while the chamber is clear.
The other
Yes, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Just a brief update to City Council on a few items that we've been working on since the last council meeting. The city's been a little bit active in providing letters for various activities going on, which certainly could have an impact with the city of Monrovia. Last week, just because of timing constraints, I wrote a letter to Metro. At the time, Metro was considering a challenge they had with a Gold Line extension down on what they call Metro East Side, which would essentially have shifted money that was dedicated from Measure R from the San Gabriel Valley to this East Side district. There was a county council opinion that Metro could move those monies, even though several here in the San Gabriel Valley were very adamant that that money should be spent and committed here within the valley. Special thanks to Councilmember Shevlin, the work we did to get some letters and do a lot of outreach to occurred at that public meeting where not only did Metro commit to keeping money here locally, but they actually directed staff to draft a resolution, and they approved a resolution that the money would stay here locally, which was, you know, a little bit more than $650 million that they were looking to move to a project outside of our area. So it was just something, I provided a copy of the letter to the council members in my last week's city manager update. We also have that available here publicly if anybody wants to see it, but I just wanted to make sure that council is aware. I did send that letter just because the timing of the meeting was last week before council had a chance to meet.
I was going to say thank you very much for acting so quickly because we had little if no time to respond to it.
Becky, once you contacted me, I talked with John Fasana, and he explained that he was in agreement with the city regarding sending a letter forward in order.
Yeah, he's the one that brought it forth at the COG meeting, the issue, and made us aware of it.
But isn't there a letter? I just received an email today regarding where Metro can amend a one-time. I guess every 10 years they can do an amendment for Measure R.
You're correct. In a very timely manner, the day after the board, Metro board, voted on this, we received a letter. We received it again today that every so many years, Metro is allowed to basically amend the ordinance. And what they're looking at doing is trying to give themselves the ability to shift money around. And so we have until the end of this month to review the letter and to provide comments. We certainly are reviewing now. We will provide comments, but we're going to remain adamantly opposed to any shifting of money away from the San Gabriel Valley to fund projects outside of the valley. We believe this is, again, it's just an attempt to take that money that's generated here locally, moving it to projects that are outside of the area.
That's what Metro frequently does. It's fascinating that they can change the rules every 2 years. Okay, thank you, Mr. Feek. Any questions?
Nope.
Okay, next up from the Foothill Workforce Development Board.
Mr. Mayor, I apologize. I had a couple other items.
Yes,
is
I'm
that
sorry.
Okay? I do apologize.
That's okay. Go ahead.
Similarly, and I'll be very quick on these three items. Similar, we received a request to support Amigos de los Rios on a green infrastructure project that they're working on within our local schools. This funding application is going to not towards our clean and safe water program, but this is a grant application that they're asking to be submitted to the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy. So as we look at this funding application, we don't see that it has any, it contradicts any of the efforts that we've undertaken. We've asked Councilmember Crudgington to review it, ask what her thoughts are. We don't see there being any harm in supporting this letter. It's a simple funding request to the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy. We are going to make sure and make it known that if they were to be asking for any kind of funding from Measure W, that go through the process that we're currently preparing for council consideration, where every project eligible for Measure W funding comes to the City Council for you to recommend approval or denial. And we'll make sure it's very clear in this request that they're aware of that.
So as far as we're aware of, and I'm kind of looking at Alex out there, there's no competition between the city and this Amigos de los Rios program that would help build permeable parking lots and bioswales in three of our schools. There's no competition for that money?
No, not at the moment.
Okay. Okay. That was the problem with W, is we're looking for Measure W money to be directed towards projects that are under the Clean Water Act that we need to comply with.
Mm.
And that was the conundrum on that. But this part, they asked me to, and sorry we couldn't give you a little more notice on this, but we just got the request today.
I understand.
And it needs to get on the Rivers and Mountains Conservancy agenda tomorrow.
Okay, good. Thank you both.
Quick update, Senate Bill 205, which was approved last year, it's essentially a stormwater compliance bill. This effectively made sure that any kind of industrial use in the community has to submit some additional paperwork as part of their business license process. I just wanted to provide a brief update to council on, you know, since January 2020 that we've been doing this. It's taken a little bit of time to get the ball rolling. It's generated a little bit of extra work for staff. There's some discussion going on across the region about what that impact has been. Some cities are of the opinion that this is an unfunded mandate. We're doing the work that the state should be doing for compliance efforts. The city of Monrovia has just been very participatory. We'll do the work. Let's just make sure that we're always pursuing clean water. The Business License Division, on average, processes about 300 renewal notices citywide every month. With the addition of the two documents that we've had to prepare as part of SB 205, we're simply generating more paperwork for applicants to complete. There's about 23 businesses that are pursuing their NPDES permit. I won't go into the acronym, but they need to have a new permit. And as we've been working with those, we've been able to issue several renewals, approximately 18, but the remaining numbers are still in limbo. But that's not at the city level, that's at the water board. We collect the information, we move it forward to the water board, and it's their time to review. So it has created a little bit of an extra workload on staff, but now as we're kind of moving in through the process, we know how it works. It's a lesser burden now, and we hope that in future years with just simple renewals, it'll take less time. So there has been a bit of an impact. I'm going to send a memo update to Gloria, but also I'll include it in my weekly email update to all of the city council this week, just so you can review, see some of the impacts it's had on staff. Final update.
Can I just say something about that before you move on? So in a nutshell, we have businesses that should have a permit with the LA Regional Water Board because by the nature of their business, when it rains, the runoff, polluted runoff from their businesses is going into the storm control channels. And we as municipalities are charged with cleaning that water up. So what the state enacted was to say, okay, Mr. and Mrs. Business A, we need you to look up the code, and we'll give you a website that makes it very easy to do that. And you're going to have to write that on your business application. And if it falls under the heading of potential runoff problems, then we're going to forward that. We're not going to do that. We're going to let you know that you need to get a permit from the LA Regional Water Board. So we've been looped into that process because the state is in fact giving us somewhat of an unfunded mandate. I was asked by the LA Regional Water Board staff at a meeting I was recently at how it was going. And so that was the reason for asking for this update. I didn't know how much confusion it was throwing our businesses in, how many people were getting caught up in this process, but it sounds like it's 20-ish that we haven't gotten the paperwork back from, and we probably processed 600 business licenses in that time. So
You know, I was also going to say, when you're talking about this, dealing with the stormwater and the affordable housing, just the cost of building housing, with all the things that have to be done now to mitigate the stormwater, developers are spending millions of dollars to mitigate these things. Not that they shouldn't or it's not a good idea, but it just all adds to the cost of housing.
So thank you for that update.
The final two items are related to Edison and electricity. The first one, if you remember, a month and a half ago or so, we talked about the Rule 20A program. The city has these credits, which are available to use for undergrounding utilities. Staff has been doing some work. Sean and Fire Chief Dover have been looking at three potential projects that are on the north side of Monrovia in the very high fire severity zones. Looking at these projects, which range from approximately a half mile in length to about three quarters of a mile in length, would be significant costs. And so what we've prepared is just an outline of what we anticipate those costs would be, because we wouldn't really know a true engineer's estimate until we actually go through the work to do it. We wouldn't be able to start the first project until the year 2035, if that came in on the low end of if the estimate came in as low as our projections are. We're still going to work with a couple of the different cities around the area to see if there are interested cities who would like to purchase the credits from us in the event that we don't want to wait for another 15 years to potentially do a project. I probably won't recommend staff bring this back to council until May. The only reason being, we receive our new allocation in May, and we would want to include that amount if we were to do some kind of exchange. So we'll bring that information back to you just at a later time than we had originally planned. The final item related to Edison is they are done with the undergrounding work here on Ivy Avenue. They're done with the shutoffs throughout the community. We're significantly sorry to the many business owners, the residents who had to go through the shutoffs, which sometimes worked well, sometimes didn't, but for the most part, it was poor communication at times from our utility, and we're just very grateful for their patience. They will do paving of the road. That won't happen for another 4 to 6 weeks, but as far as parking being open, it's now open, and they're done with all their work, and that's my report for tonight.
Go ahead, Larry.
No, you go ahead.
I wanted to ask on the electricity with Edison. Is there a claim process for anyone that needs or desires to file a claim due to the problems with those shutoffs?
They do have a claim process. Why don't I look to include it in my weekly update just to make sure it's available out there? I'm not sure what Edison's pension is for paying the claims, but we'll make sure that everyone has the information.
Thank you.
Dylan, can you add to your to-do list the Summer Youth Employment Service?
Yes.
Yes, program?
Yes, of course.
So we can start on that.
Okay.
Okay, are we done? Thank you.
No.
Diane Russell, I am so sorry I called you a little earlier than I should have, so I apologize for that.
That's all right.
But we want to welcome you.
Thank you so much. I'm very happy to be here. Good evening, Mayor Adams. Good evening, FETC Policy Board Member Larry Spicer and the rest of City Council. My name is Diane Russell Carter. I'm the Executive Director for Foothill Workforce Development Board. I'm here tonight to speak to you about the workforce development services we provide to your local area. Ta-da. All right. Excuse me. First of all, I do want to thank all of the policy board members, local elected officials, who are the reason why we have a local workforce development board, local workforce development area. Our local workforce development area is designated by the governor, and it has been in effect for over 35 years. It was initially created and maintains as a joint powers agreement. Again, with six cities. And this is the makeup of the policy board. And again, Mayor Pro Tem does sit on that policy board. I'd like you to know that I meet with this board regularly, and I really have to tell you that they're very proud
of what they do. They're very proud of their cities, and they work very hard, and they work me very hard in making sure that everyone in their cities are receiving the workforce development services necessary to make this a good living community for everyone. Okay. We are funded by the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. Before, it's had several other names. It's federal funding. We were the Workforce Innovation Opportunity Act in 2014. Before that, we were the Workforce Innovations Act and the longstanding act, and some of you may remember, is the Job Training Partnership Act. I've been in workforce development for over 30 years, and I've been with Foothill for almost 29. So sad to say I've been through all of these acts. Okay, again, what it does is provide federal funds for qualified populations to receive workforce development services leading to self-sufficient employment. We call that now high road jobs. And it's a really important category because we're now looking at jobs not just for how much they pay, but that they are livable wages, that the jobs have livable wages, offer benefits, and the most important, an identifiable career ladder. That's really become more of the anchor of what a high road job is. You know, we've heard dead-end jobs for a long time, and obviously none of us, it doesn't sound very good, and we really wouldn't like to be in a dead-end job. So now we're looking for those that are high road jobs as our goal for our customers. Here's a sample of services we provide. I was trying to put it in a way that would not give you the law, but I think the best way that I can explain it is that everything starts with assessment. When an individual comes in and they talk to us about employment, we begin assessing right as they enter our doors. And by the way, we're headquartered in Pasadena at 1207 East Green Street. We're about two blocks down from PCC. But we start with assessment once they enter the front doors by asking them, what is it that we can do for you? What is your current situation? And we go anywhere from a personal interview to various assessment tools to help them identify proficiencies, aptitudes, goals. Then from there, we move to information. And we have job counselors there that talk to these individuals and provide them with labor market information. Some people come in and they want to be sewing machine maintenance people, and that's not a really in-demand career right now. So we provide them with the labor market information so that they're able to have that, know how to obtain it, and how to make a really knowledge-based and data-based decision. From there, we go to the development of an individual employment plan. And we really work the plan. And the plan is not developed just with the customers and the staff at the one-stop, the America Job Center of California, one-stop career center. The plan is really developed with the customer, the one-stop staff, and an array of partners. That's why now we're considered the Workforce Development System versus the Job Trainings Act program. We're required by federal law to have certain partners. We have partners here in Monrovia, Monrovia Adult School, Foothill Unity. They are two of our partners. Our employer partner, we have Monrovia Chamber. Sorry over there. And it really is more of a comprehensive plan to move an individual into, as I said, a high road job situation. At Foothill, we also support a lot, and this is the action piece. We support and recommend a lot of programs that are what we call earn and learn. That typically is a program where an individual goes to work for an employer and they're learning there on the job. It could be a pre-apprenticeship, it could be an apprenticeship program, it can be on the job training, where on the job training they receive 50% of their wages are reimbursed by our program, a reimbursement in a cash check, excuse me, that goes right back to the employer for the amount of time that they spent training that individual. Direct placement and work experience. We do a lot of paid work experience with our youth clients. That's, and you have probably had some of them or seen them. They work in the local parks. They work in City Hall. They work for Retail Party City. They're a big work site for us. But for Foothill, this is really important because, again, as I said, I've spent a lot of years. I've been the executive director for 3.5 years, but I spent my former 25 years in operations and building and operating special target population programs. And what we've seen and works in this area, again, we're a 6-city consortium, Pasadena, Monrovia, Arcadia, Duarte, Sierra Madre, and South Pasadena. What we've seen in our consortium is that the minute you allow someone to make a dollar, their life changes. Now, we agree that it's really important to get certifications. It's really important to advance your education. But we have people who need to make changes in their lives right now, whether it is to pay rent, as housing was the topic of the meeting tonight, pay for childcare, or even get to work or school the next day. again, we really push to earn and learn, and we've been quite successful in placing a number of people in these opportunities that turn then into full-time high-road jobs. Okay, the funding map. Just a small map on how we do receive our funding. Our funds come from the Department of Labor, and then they go to the state, and they're housed in the Office of Employment Development Program. From there, it goes to the City of Pasadena, who, by the JPA, is the fiscal agent. I, myself, am an employee of the City of Pasadena. Then that money is given for workforce development opportunities to all of the cities within the consortium. And here we have nuts and bolts. Our 2019-2020 allocations of $3.9 million, our full budget, and then you have the sub-allotments per city that we received for 2018-2019. That's the only last full year that we had available. Here you can see what the other cities receive. This sub-allotment is determined by a formula that is written in the Act. And the formula includes the population, the unemployment rate, and the number of special population youth. The special population youth, foster youth. We have a huge foster youth population in San Gabriel Valley, pregnant teens, justice-involved youth. So that is how they determine by formula how the allocations are divvied up. We, as the local workforce development board and system, have no say in this kind of, in the sub-allotment. We also, though, have the opportunity to apply for competitive grants. And some of the money of the 3.9 did come to us for grants. We have a veterans grant right now, and we also have a grant for HirePath, which covers a number of layoffs that happened in the San Gabriel Valley. We have TIDI, which I believe was in Duarte. We had Bank of America. And so we've had those grants, which add to that final budget figure for the last 2 years. Then I've given you here a summary of participant data. We've registered over the last year 10,017 people. And all of these numbers are kept in a state provided database. You've probably heard of it before, CalJobs. It's not only the database that our participants use to get their information and to put their resumes out and to receive job offers and to look at possible job openings, but it also maintains our data. So 10,017 that have been registered, a number of services provided, 30,000. It's like 3-to-1. And this is really high. What we're finding is unemployment, we're in San Gabriel Valley anywhere from 3.5 to a little over 4. And what we have now is what's being called the untapped labor market. And that is individuals who are not often the first ones to be chosen for a job. They have the skills and they have the desire, but because they may have been just as involved, they're not counted. Because they don't have a bachelor's degree, they're not selected. So we're finding that we really are providing more services per individual than we have in the past. We have 108 registered with zip codes from Monrovia.
Where are they from, Diane?
I can tell you according to zip codes, it came from CalJobs. It came from a CalJobs report. And it's either zip codes or just the city, Monrovia, because you can go in and filter them out.
So if I'm reading this correctly, you've got 10,000 individuals registered and 108 of them are from Monrovia?
Yes.
So that's 1%.
Yes.
That seems awfully low.
Yes.
So the majority of the people are coming from Pasadena, right?
I did not queue Pasadena's numbers. I didn't queue any other numbers except for your numbers.
Well, I was just looking at the funding.
Yes, now it is the most populous city.
I understand that.
It is the most populous city. And remember, it is population. It's also unemployment rate and special population of youth. So yes, the 108 enrolled, and then we have provided though to the city of Monrovia work experience programs for youth, and to date we've paid $137,000 in work experience wages for over the last 12 months.
And that's over and above the $150,000.
That is out of the $150,000.
Okay, that's out of it.
Yes.
I'm just curious, and obviously if you work with these numbers all the time, obviously you have six cities. Are all the other cities that low and Pasadena is just really high to make up for the 10,000? It just seems unnaturally low at 108.
Well, I agree. And I'll tell you, I'm the executive director now, but I was operations person for a very long time. What we have decided and implemented over about the last 3 months is, again, as I said, we're working with a different type of population right now, more barriered individuals. And so the barriered individuals are not so apt to come to our office. Again, we are headquartered in Pasadena. We do some outreach in Monrovia Adult School. We also do some outreach through Foothill Unity. But still, the numbers speak for themselves. So over about the last 90 days, and I got an email that Mayor Pro Tem Spicer sent an email to my staff today inquiring about it. We are now taking our services to where the people are. We got a request from...
Mobile unit?
Yes, we have a mobile unit. We have a mobile unit.
Ms. Russell, the only reason I requested it because I happened to receive a flyer from DeWardy.
Yes.
That's how I knew about, came about knowing, you know, that it was available.
Right.
But it seemed like something like that would come out of a policy board meeting.
Well, not necessarily, because it is operations. It is operations. However, we have our next policy board meeting scheduled on Monday. And so we can talk about operations at that point, but we do have outreach and activities going on in the Monrovia area. Again, as I said, we came to the conclusion that we needed to bring our services out to the individuals. So we started going to different parks, places, again, DeWardy, to reach outreach to individuals. And we will be bringing that also to Monrovia. We have here already scheduled as, again, part of the outreach, and I think we have a flyer.
Veterans Resource Center?
No, for the Career Expo.
Right.
Yeah, at Monrovia. And it is not just for veterans.
Okay.
So again, we're doing a little more outreach.
Can I ask then, if we get out of that almost $4 million, wait, don't.
What happened?
Yeah. we get 150,578. And of that, we've paid out, or you've paid out 137,000. What happens to the 20,578, the difference?
We just keep going.
So it rolls over, or
when we provide our services, we don't provide it based on the individual budget and allocation for each city. We provide it comprehensively. So
if we had more applicants, we could accommodate more than the 150,578?
Yes, and we have. We have in the past. Again, that is really just the baseline. That's the baseline. What we do is we administer it comprehensively. Whoever comes through our doors, they're from those six cities. We make it our business to serve them, whether it is in one of the direct earn and learn opportunities, activities, or just seeing and doing a resume scrub or some interviewing skills. We never turn it away by virtue of the fact and say, you know, Monrovia has already used their allocation. I'm sorry you can't come here. We've never done that. And I've been here, as I said, for 29 years. Okay, our program performance, they have 2017, 2018 numbers available. Again, this is from the state's CalJobs database. This tells you the outcomes. We're held to these performance standards in order to even receive an allocation. And these performance standards are developed by the Department of Labor, then sent to the state of California, and then sent to us as local areas. The employee Q2 means that after a person leaves our program, when they exit our program, they are still employed 2 quarters after they've left, so at least 6 months. The employee Q4 is they're still employed a year after they've left. The median earnings gives you, I believe this is the 6 month. It's the 6 month earnings. No, quarter. I'm sorry. This is the quarterly earnings. And then the credential rate of those who have gone to vocational training, at least 85% adult, 93% dislocated worker, and 100% of the youth received a standardized credential, and that which is industry recognized. the skills gain, that's a new standard. We are just now implementing it 2 years into WIOA. The skills standard basically represents a pre and a post test, which evaluates the skill sets coming in and the skill sets after they've completed their employment plan through us. Again, partners working together for a greater good. We have our FETC policy board and our Foothill Workforce Development Board. We have two different boards. The Workforce Development Board is representative of all of our partners, and it is 51% private sector. Our chair of the Workforce Development Board is here with me tonight, Dan Lean. Again, we work with the Chamber, we work with City of Hope, and there was some conversation about Metro. We are talking with Metro. We've been contacted and working with them about their Win LA program. Win LA was started 2 years ago, and it was a program based on underserved populations and how to get them jobs in the metro. They started off with a very large cohort of about 200, took them through some additional training, interviewing, testing, and then out of the cohort, they ended up with about 50 employees. They want to do part two, and we've been working with them to bring part two to the San Gabriel Valley. Part two would involve, again, an opportunity for individuals from underserved populations to have access to job opportunities, training in interviewing and soft skills, and then the opportunity to apply for final jobs. The one thing that's different and it's a little exciting about the WinLA Phase 2 is that Metro will soon be opening or operating a different kind of transportation program. They're going to do something similar to Uber and Lyft. And they need 90 drivers. So again, we spoke maybe about a month ago. They're finalizing everything, and we look very soon to have a Metro Win LA Jobs Comes to San Gabriel Valley event.
So where does all the money come from to fund this program? Is that out of that $4 million?
No, these are just our partners. Yeah, they don't receive any funding.
Oh, okay.
Well, Monrovia Adult School does, and Citrus does. If an individual chooses to go there, then we could pay their tuition. Labor.
Diane, how do you track some of the youth, say, that are going over to the adult center for training? How do you track?
Go enrolled in the adult center? We can pull that out of CalJobs. Monrovia Adult School is an eligible training provider, and so they are included on the CalJobs as an option for training. So we can pull that based on Monrovia Adult School.
So you don't routinely break out, this is the numbers from Arcadia that are going to school, these are the numbers from Monrovia that are going to school. Both Becky and I spent a lot of years on the Community Services Commission and have dealt with a lot of groups that provide service to a number of communities. And it would be really helpful in understanding better what you're doing and how Monrovia is benefiting if you were able to break these numbers out by cities.
Absolutely. I will work with... Vice Mayor Pro Tem. I have six cities. And I have to remember my titles. Mayor Pro Tem.
Don't you forget it.
Policy Board Member. Policy Board Member Larry Spicer to get that information to you. We can sit down and make a determination of what data points you want to pull. And then if we're not able to do it, we can send it to EDD in Sacramento to see if they can pull it.
Yeah, no problem.
Again, we are partnering with unions, vocational rehab, TANF, which is food stamps, SNAP. TANF is aid, Justice Department. That's a really big one. We are not only local workforce development areas, we're also now a region. In the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, it calls for local workforce boards to become regions. There are 45 workforce development boards in the state of California. There are now 14 regions, and there are 7 boards in our region. We are called the LA Basin Region. It includes LA County, City of LA, Foothill, Verdugo, Celico, and South Bay and Pacific Gateway. So we just received a grant, and we're a little disappointed by the amount. It is only $8 million between the 7 of us to spend on prison-to-employment individuals, people who were justice-involved, again, to come out, have the same opportunity to access the services that I went over earlier. And I have to tell you, it's getting really hard. Again, you know, having a history in workforce development, the cost, I don't think that the state or DOL, they're actually really being able to keep up with the cost per participant, the cost of what it takes to put someone to work. The prison to employment, that program in itself was allocated at $12,000 per participant.
So, if I were magic, and I could grant your wishes for the prison to employment program alone, how much would you like to see your organization able to get their hands on in order to really do the job?
As a region, and I have to say for a region, because this is a regional project, mm-hmm. $20 million.
Because we run into our legislators all the time. And they're very proud of what they do. But this is, I agree with you completely. I think this is where we're really falling behind.
Yes, it is. When we made application, the Los Angeles Regional Planning Unit, we're the largest of the planning units. We have the most amount of cities, LA County. And when we first made the application, we made it for $17 million. And out of $17 million, we received 8.5. Something a little close to nine, but still is not enough.
Yeah,
not enough for the work that has to be done.
So Diane, the program that they have out at PCC, mm-hmm. that's in conjunction with the Flint Ridge Center,
mm-hmm.
regarding the electricians, construction workers, and things of that nature, that type of field.
Yes.
So you guys aren't connected to that?
Yes.
In no way?
That's felons,
right?
Yes, exactly. Well, one point of clarification. PCC, the Flint Ridge Foundation is located in Pasadena, and they serve justice-involved individuals and help them get into construction apprenticeships. PCC was the training provider, but PCC was not able to enroll only individuals with felons. They could not discriminate against those who were not justice involved.
I don't want to say how the program started.
But they couldn't do it.
Right.
So now the Flint Ridge Foundation works with the Orange County, LA County Trade Council, and they provide the training. So that program is still, I don't know if it's at PCC.
Because
now that I don't know.
I send individuals over that is just, I'm not saying I hang around a bunch of felons now. I'm just saying.
Well, there was that one time.
I send people over to, I think his name is Daniel Torres.
Yes.
Over at the Flint Ridge Center. And from there, they go over to PCC and go through that apprenticeship
program. I'm not sure what they're doing right now, what the process is. Daniel Torres, we just met with him last week. First of all, Daniel Torres is he's a foothill baby. He came to us, he was 14 years old. And we're very proud of him and his position. Daniel, myself, my deputy director, and South Bay Workforce Development Board met last week to talk about how we can begin to implement an even larger construction program, pre-apprenticeship. So, and PCC was not at the table. Now, that would be a question for Foothill board member Salvatrice Como. She's the CTE dean for Pasadena. So we have that board meeting next week also. And I'm going to be sure to ask Salvatrice that question.
Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm.
And then I think that I just wanted to say thank you for your continued support.
Diane, thank you so much. We appreciate you coming down this evening.
Thank you, sir. Thank you,
everyone. Any questions for Diane?
I think Gloria and Larry brought it up, the breakdown for the cities. That would be very interesting because 108 registrants
And for the folks at home, Mayor Pro Tem Spicer is our representative on this board and does a great job for Monrovia. So, Larry, thank you for your time involved in that.
Yeah, I know I had the actual unemployment rate, and I still may have it under there. I know for Monrovia, though, it's under 4% unemployment, and that does have a lot to do with it. But exactly as we were saying, you know, it's a harder-to-serve population, and we are making an attempt at getting out rather than waiting for them to come to us.
Very good. Thank you so much. We appreciate you both coming down tonight.
Thank you.
And thank you for voting.
Thank you.
You bet. Okay, we'll now move on to reports of city council members, and we'll start with Mrs. Shevlin for
Thank
her
you.
Brief report.
Yes, I'll be brief. Last Friday, I did attend a Foothill Transit Strategic Planning session. It was very, very interesting. We talked a lot and strategized about ridership overall. It's not just Foothill Transit, but has been going down, and the ideas that we could, how we could get ridership going up. And I've mentioned before, public transportation is hugely subsidized. And right now for Foothill, I think they get about 14% of recovery on the fare box. So at any rate, also talked about the possibility of Foothill working out an agreement with Metro on the use of a lot for some temporary housing. So you're talking about some partnerships and doing some innovative things there. There is an issue of talking about what Gloria had brought up earlier about the 500 feet from the freeway. There have been many requests that that could be waived, so some of those properties could be freed up and funds could be freed up to provide some housing. Obviously, you'd want it to be, though you don't want to have them breathing the fumes from the freeway. But then I also, on Saturday, as mentioned, attended the San Gabriel Valley Consortium on Homelessness, and it was also, it was hosted by them and at Mountainside Communion Church, and that was brought to us by Assemblymember Holden and Supervisor Barger. The title of that was Housing for Future Policy and Solutions Dialogue. And he did. He made a pledge. He really is trying to get our redevelopment dollars back, what that would look like in the future. But he really, that is high in his priorities. And I did want to mention, since it's early registration, and I have been able to thankfully participate in this every year, the Fountain to the Falls Run Walk. Early registration opens March 8th. So be checking out the city's website on that. The race day is actually May 9th, but early registration starts on March 8th. And early registration is $35, and the event day registration is $45. So that was my little tidbit. And, you know, I didn't ask you in your report, but we had brought up the thing about native trees and the ordinance. So I don't know where that is on your game plan, but if you could let us know when we might be hearing back on that. Thank you. And happy voting day.
Yes. Mrs. Crudgington.
Briefly, the team is at work attempting to wrangle, or maybe I should say wrest, every measure W dollar we possibly can out of the county. And we're not pleased at the very beginning, but the team is on it and working hard to make sure that Monrovia gets at least its fair share.
Good. Thank you very much. Mr. Blackburn.
I don't have a report, but I'd like to request that it be agendized for our next meeting, that we discuss making Election Day a city holiday and not holding city council meetings on election night.
Frankly, I think that's a great idea.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if we could agendize that, that'd be wonderful. Thank you.
So we'll get that on our next agenda?
I believe we can get it on the next agenda, okay. But I'll let you know if for some reason it's not on the next.
Correct. Okay. Thank you.
Why couldn't we get it on the next agenda? It's 2 weeks out, right?
It is 2 weeks out, but I will say that the agenda on the 17th is going to be a very heavy agenda. You're going to have the Joint Planning Commission meeting to talk about accessory dwelling units. You also have the audit and the mid-year budget adjustment, so it's going to be a heavy one. I think we can get it on.
I
can we put everything on the consent? No, just
no.
Okay.
I think it will be brief at best.
Got it.
Yeah. Thank you. Great idea. Mayor Pro Tem Spicer.
No report, Mayor.
Okay. Thank you. Okay. I have one thing to fill a vacancy on our Planning Commission. And Planning Commissioner Bill Beebe had to resign. He moved outside of the city of Monrovia. So we had one application from Mr. Darrell Brook, and it is recommended that his term begin April 1st of 2020, and that is the recommendation from the interview committee.
So moved it be.
It's moved.
Second.
It's seconded. Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Any objection? Then that will be the order. Thank you. Then we move on to, I think that completes our evening this evening. Thank you all for attending. Thank you for watching from home. Thank you for voting for those who did. And for those who didn't, try to do it next time. And we're going to go home and watch the results. Thank you all. Thank you.